You know, I was wondering, you know, if she could keep on, because the force has got a lot of power, and it makes me feel like it makes me feel like that.
Just rising up. Good morning. I would like to welcome all of you for joining us. My name is Terrence Woodson, and I am the Events and Program Manager here at the Seattle Chamber of Commerce. I'd like to welcome all of you to our Elevate Northwest Conference. This is our third annual conference. And of course, this year it is virtual. Our conference is dedicated to the growth and success of small businesses in the Seattle metro region. And we want to play a role in building relationships that create an environment where small businesses can continue to flourish and innovate. Before we get started, I would like to thank our presenting sponsor, Kaiser Permanente. Kaiser Permanente exists to provide high quality, affordable healthcare services and to improve the health of their members and the communities they serve. They are trusted partners in total health, collaborating with people to help them thrive and creating communities that are among the healthiest in the nation. Now, before we get to our wonderful speaker today, just wanna go over a few webinar logistics. Please make sure your microphone is on mute. Angela will speak for about 25 to 30 minutes, and then we'll take your questions for about 20 to 25 minutes. If you need technical assistance, please use the chat box and my colleagues, Hannah and Betsy, will assist you. Feel free to use the Q&A box to send us any questions, and Angela will respond to those questions during the Q&A session. Now, I'd like to introduce to you our keynote speaker for the Elevate Conference, and that person is Angela Shen. She is the founder and CEO of Savor Seattle. Angela is a self-proclaimed food evangelist, and this translates into a huge love of eating, shopping for, and cooking food. After she graduated from the Wharton School, she moved to Chicago and worked in brand management at Quaker Oats, where she worked on iconic brands including Life Cereal and Quaker Oatmeal. A fresh start brought her to Seattle, where she has never been happier to be so close to fresh seafood, local wine, and artisan cheese. She owns her own incredibly abundant life to a 25 plus passionate team at Savor Seattle and a loving family. During the past 13 years in Seattle, she has had the honor of being named Puget Sound Business Journal's Top 40 Under 40, a Seattle Tourism Ambassador, and a Nellie Cashem Business Owner of the Year finalist. She also currently serves on the Visit Seattle Board of Directors. In her spare time, she enjoys laughing with her two children, sweating it out in HIIT classes, and traveling the world. Her favorite foods include sushi, tacos, and red wine. There are a few things she won't eat, and durium is one of them. All of you who are here today are in for a treat, so now I would like to welcome Angela.
Hi there, everyone. Hi, my name is Angela Shen, and I'm the founder of Savor Seattle. For the past 13 years, my team and I have been in the business of leading delicious food tours through Pike Place Market, the heart and soul of Seattle's food scene, and the downtown Seattle area. We've really enjoyed taking people through an exploration through the lens of our stomachs, showcasing the best of Seattle's food scene. When COVID-19 hit Seattle, tourism came to a screeching halt. There were no more cruise ships, and all the restaurants were forced to close, couldn't do food tours anymore. So overnight, we went from being a very successful, established food tour company to scrambling and hemorrhaging refunds. We had to let 12 people go, and that was a really difficult time for our small family. In that same breath, I told them that I wanted to bring them back. So we had to change everything overnight. So instead of bringing people to the Pike Place Market, we decided we would bring Pike Place Market to the people. And so each week, we curate an iconic market box of 9 different Pike Place Market merchants. essentially a taste of Pike Place delivered right to your doorstep. So in every box, you get a bouquet of market flowers, a box of fresh seasonal produce, and whole bean coffee. And we rotate and feature a mix of different small businesses within the Pike Place Market community. You know, if you're not familiar with Seattle, Pike Place Market is really the heart and soul of the small business food community. It's made up of over 500 small business artisans. And when COVID-19 hit and the vast majority of the Pike Place Market was forced to shut down, many of these vendors didn't have another outlet, including all of the famous flower vendors. And so for us, it was our calling to still be a voice and a way for them to provide their products to the end consumer. And so by creating this box, we enabled them to stay in business. One of our partners, Roz Pinedo of Urban Farm, said that the 1 week of being in the box enabled him to pay for an entire month's worth of operating expenses. Because of our box, Frank's Produce was able to bring back two of their employees within the first week. So with one easy, delicious purchase, it was 9 micropayments to different small businesses here within Seattle. And with every purchase of a market box, we donate $5 back to the Pike Place Market Safety Net Fund. So this fund was set up to help residents and merchants within the market who were economically impacted by the closures relating to COVID-19. And so to date, we are now in our 15th week of this major business pivot. We've donated over $38,000 to the Safety Net Fund, as well as over $600,000 in direct sales to small businesses within the Pike Place Market community. So during a time of need when people were stuck at home with their children and trying to remote work and were nervous about going out or providing food on the table for their families, this was a great way to meet their needs, but then also support the local food community here in Seattle. We were able to bring back employees. We were also able to fund expansion into additional warehouse space so that we can fulfill more box orders, and then also amplify other small business voices within our community that needed help. So, for example, 2 weeks ago, we launched the Seattle Solidarity Box. It features 11 Black-owned food businesses here within Seattle, and we donated all the profits from the first 200 boxes sold, plus $5 for the Black Lives Matter Fund. And to date, we've sold over 1,500 Seattle Solidarity Boxes and donated over $13,000 back to the Black Lives Matter Fund. We're excited to continue on what we now affectionately call Box Life and continue to deliver the best of Seattle's food scene delivered right to people's doorsteps and now shipped nationwide. Thank you so much for your support. Hey, look at that. I was on mute. Sorry, you guys. I am like the worst when it comes to technology. Okay. All right. So I'll start over again. Thank you so much for having me here today. I'm really honored to get to share a piece of our story with you. started with that video because I feel like it gives a good showcase of what Saver Seattle was like before COVID-19, the pivot that we took, and then what we're doing today. So I'm going to dive right in here. Bear with me here. So there were a few questions that were submitted to us for this keynote, and so I'll make sure to address some of those. So the slides here will guide that conversation. So the first things that we did when we were trying to decide on what to do or to even know whether or not to pivot was to really look at the data and trends. So COVID-19 hit Asia first. So we actually had a few months to preview what it was going to soon look like when it spread to the rest of the world. And with China being Seattle's largest international inbound tourism market, we knew already that Seattle's tourism industry was going to be forecasted to decrease by 20%. And that was when COVID was only in China. I recall a conversation I had with my dad 6 weeks into COVID in China, and he was recounting stories from family members about how all these restaurants and service industry brick and mortar shops were closed, and that people weren't allowed to leave their homes, and frankly, were afraid to do so, and thus even groceries were being delivered online, or ordered online rather, and delivered directly to people's doorsteps. Small businesses were going belly up, and he told me to be really grateful that COVID-19 hadn't started in the United States. In his words, he said, imagine what your business would have looked like then. Well, turns out none of us had to wait all that long to find out. A few weeks later, COVID had spread to Italy, and that's when I knew that it wasn't going to be contained regionally, and it was going to be on our shores before we knew it. So we just didn't expect that it would hit Seattle first, of course. But we knew then it was likely to be a global pandemic. It wasn't going to be contained. And because of that, it was likely to stay here for a long time. So even though, you know, it feels like there's a great bit of uncertainty each day as we're each soldiering through this pandemic, there is still data and trends that we can look to because, you know, we may be the first city in the US that have been impacted, but, you know, it only really takes looking at the countries that were hit with it earlier than us and see what their trajectories look like to know what our recovery could look like, or even what the Southern Hemisphere looks like right now because they're in winter, to know what might be in store for us. So once we knew it's time to pivot, we had to decide what we were going to do. And as a brand marketer in my past life at Quaker Oats, I always tried to put myself in the shoes of our consumers first. So if you can identify the pain points in your customers' lives and meet their needs emotionally and functionally, I think that's a win-win. With COVID hitting Seattle first, my first thought was that there was going to be a growing population of people who were stuck at home, scared, stressed. You just add on some children being stuck at home too, and it was going to be a pressure cooker. And with most meal delivery services, you know, we're talking about a one-to-one relationship. If you need dinner, you order once from DoorDash. You need lunch, you gotta go back on the app, order another meal for your family. It's not efficient. And as you know, there's a lot of consumer backlash against these services at a time when these service fees were just really impacting restaurants or small businesses so adversely. So in the midst of all this, we were watching our beloved small business food community suffer. The general public, you know, Seattle is a really emboldened city and has a lot of local pride, and we want to help, but maybe didn't know how to do so efficiently and safely. So that's actually how we came up with the solution of doing this aggregated food delivery at Pike Place Markets, Merchants, Eats and Treats. We've always had roots in that community, and it's a place with nearly 500 businesses that had to close overnight. This enabled us to continue being ambassadors for the Seattle food community, just in a very different way than our food tours. So functionally, it was keeping families fed for multiple meal occasions all at once, while also supporting several small businesses in the community with just one easy transaction. Now, after making the decision to pivot, we had to move quickly, but intentionally. And as a leader, I really pride myself for communicating with truth and vulnerability. And the truth really was that I'd never done any of this before. I mean, have you led a team through a pandemic? I mean, if I had all the answers, then this would be a piece of cake. But clearly, none of us have done this before. So the first order of business was to really tell the team the train was coming well before it hit us. So as COVID was spreading across Asia and then into Europe, we kept them apprised as to what it meant for our business and the steps that we were taking to proactively preserve their jobs and livelihoods for as long as we possibly could. When COVID hit, we were holding nearly daily meetings, sharing the very real state of affairs with, you know, restaurants suddenly closing, including many of our cornerstone food tour partners like Tom Douglas and all the Kevin Davis restaurants. We were hemorrhaging refunds from cancellations. I told the team it was probably a matter of days before we would have to cease operations entirely. And I think this truthfulness and candor engendered a sense of togetherness in the face of something that was so daunting. And it was really moving how everyone leaned in to do all that they could to help, including taking voluntary pay cuts. It was just a tremendously emotional time, but to know that we were in it together felt like there's just no words to describe what that's like. We knew that the window of time for generosity was a very short one. We were mere weeks away from this our entire country going into panic mode. I mean, we ran out of toilet paper at Costco on our coast before, you know, DC caught up a few weeks later. So that was the time that we knew we had to proactively reach out to customers and request things like deferrals on refunds and conversions to gift certificates instead of issuing straight refunds. That helped initially to stem that outflow of refunds because we had over $250,000 of revenue on the books for the year already, and we knew we would be crippled overnight if we didn't move quickly. And in that same vein, that's when we started a GoFundMe campaign immediately, articulating our plan to pivot to a curated food delivery service that supported our local food business community. This GoFundMe campaign enabled us to get a quick injection of funds to test this new idea. And so we launched our first iconic market box with a flyer on social media in week one with a Venmo and PayPal link. Like, we didn't have a website. It was really bootleg. And our goal was to sell 48 boxes that first week, just to see if it would work. We called it the Beta 48. And with the feedback we received from that first week, including people kept asking, can you give us flowers in the box? Which we initially had said, there's no way we're going to do fresh flowers and fresh produce. Well, by week two, we had iterated, and what do you know? Now we have fresh flowers and produce in every box. And we continue to expand each week. In terms of communication strategy, as I mentioned before, with our staff and vendors and customers, candor and vulnerability were really important. Obviously, we didn't know whether this was going to work, but you know, everyone was rallying for us. They wanted to see us succeed. So with customers and vendors, we really brought everyone into our vision. And at each pass or milestone, we shared our results and the impact in the communities that we were serving. So, for example, it is really important for us to share how much we've donated and to which organizations and how many boxes we've sold that supported the Black Lives Matter Fund. These are things that, you know, people want to feel like they're part of, and they are, because each individual person in our Seattle community enabled us to do this work. And I think this truthfulness about when we've failed to or make mistakes, because frankly, you know, we've only been doing this now for, I think, 24 weeks or so. We need an extra touch of grace because we don't have any idea what we're doing. We've been in the food tour business for the last 13 years. And so I think, you know, people really do understand and are willing to give a pass when, you know, not everything goes perfectly all the time. So once we were up and running selling food boxes, the first few weeks and months were like absolute insanity. The phrase that I use to describe what we live through is this building of a parachute while we're falling off the building. Everything from finding out that there was a national paper bag shortage, who knew, to running out of fulfillment space. It was a wild roller coaster that, frankly, we're still on. Even though the dust has settled from that initial mayhem of our pivot, there are obviously ongoing challenges, ones that are simply exacerbated by the uncertainty that a pandemic brings. The first is this lack of accurate forecasting. Next week, next month, next year, who knows? I mean, we've seen declines and gains from week to week that range anywhere from -40% to +200%. So this unpredictability makes capital investment decisions really difficult. As well, there's a huge shift in our consumer demographics. In our previous world of operating food tours, 60% of our customer base were from out of town. Now nearly 90% of our business is local. So it's a totally different go-to-market strategy that is brand new to us. As well, there is significantly more competition now, which is causing us to take stock in what our competitive advantages are long-term. So why would a customer choose us over any other food delivery service like Smith Brothers? And so when we think about that, it obviously lends itself to the question of, you know, when the pandemic is over, will we return to doing food tours? I think the key is to stay flexible and really do think about what our competitive advantages are. And one of those, I believe, is our heritage in Pike Place Market, as well as our roots coming from food tours. Our team of tour guides are experts in the local food scene. We take people to the best eats in town every single day. So curating and distilling down what we think should go in a box each week kind of makes sense. We are trusted experts in that capacity. And when the world goes back to normal, quotation marks, we do anticipate operating food tours again. I mean, but what's more interesting is to consider now what new avenues for business are available due to being in a virtual environment, like the Zoom call, for example, that simply didn't exist before. So stay tuned. We are stitching our parachute as we speak. So in terms of advice I would give to those considering the pivot, is the biggest one is to lean into your community. I would ask for the things you need, and even the things that you don't think that you can get. Saver Seattle would not have been able to scale as quickly as we had without the support of countless people who came out of the woodwork to our aid, from graphic designers to technology to power our deliveries and an e-commerce system and even restaurant fulfillment space, we wouldn't have been able to do it on our own. The second piece of advice would be to make incremental moves. So in the space of uncertainty, and for us, whether or not it makes sense to make huge capital investments, if we don't know what's next or how long things will last, you know, we should be trying to hedge against sinking a ton of investment into something that wouldn't be sustainable over the long term. So whatever lines of business you decide to get into, they should still fit together after things are, quote unquote, back to normal. And last but not least, yes, know that you can absolutely do this. One of the hardest things I was initially faced with, amongst a lot of ugly crying, was that this thought that I don't know if I'm cut out for this, which probably sounds funny, but I definitely questioned whether the entrepreneur in me still had what it took to pour in the hours, delve into the unknown, and start all over again. It was in this idea of like starting all over again that felt so disheartening at first. Like, how could I go back to square one after working so hard for 13 years to get to where I was? And as it turned out, really, it's this excitement and building something new and being in learning mode all over again that inspired newfound energy that's led us to where we are today. So who knows where it can take you? Maybe higher than your wildest dreams were before. This honestly could be your year. It's yours for the making. In terms of outlook for small businesses in Seattle, I really do believe that it'll take makers like you and I to continue to be loud voices to advocate for change. Our city's governing bodies simply don't value small businesses in the ways that they should. And maybe what's born out of this pandemic is a reset button for all of us to be heard and to be seen as valued parts of this economic engine of Seattle. Thank you so much. And I'm excited to be able to share a part of our story and take any of your questions.
Great. Thanks, Angela, for sharing your story and your wisdom. We all very much appreciate it. We do have a few questions. Question one, do you have any plans for any future partnerships to create new boxes?
Sure do. So each week within the Pike Place Market box program, we change our partnerships on a weekly basis because that curation changes. But then on top of that, we always have a separate non-Pike Place Market, you know, broader Seattle area curation that ties into a timely theme. So for example, right now we have a Seattle TV Stars box, which features 9 different chefs and artisans that have been on the Food Network at some point. And the beneficiary for that box is Fair Start. So for those that aren't as familiar, right now Fair Start is supporting emergency meals for those that are at risk in our community with school lunch programs, frontline meals, and so forth. And so with every box that a customer purchases from us, we donate an emergency meal to Fair Start's program. So yeah, we'll have lots of new curations. If you have friends or you are a food maker that would love to be a part of our box program, please contact us, send us an email. We're constantly trying new products and are eager to work with you.
Great, thank you. A question from Lorraine. Because of your customer demographic shift, how did you market to local consumers for the box? And how did they learn of your new service?
You know, one of the benefits of being stuck at home for as long as we were is that we were getting everything on a mobile device. So everybody was very glued to their phones. So social media actually ended up being a huge part of our outreach to locals. And when you're cooped up at home and you have all this new time, people really like to work on their Instagram photography skills. And so there's nothing like getting a fresh box of surprise goodies delivered each week and then photographing them and sharing those with others. So it's really the people who bought these boxes that help us spread the word, because they're so excited to showcase what they got. And we love sharing those stories too. Like, oh, what did you make? What did you try putting together? And they're unexpected for us too. So it's really fun to see.
Great, thank you. Next question from Alan. Do you have a particular person or a group of people that you confide with for business advice?
You know, it's a challenging one, because as many entrepreneurs can probably relate to, is that it feels kind of lonely at times. I have a few different groups that I've been a part of over the years. Things like the Women Presence Organization was a group I was part of recently. I have great mentors that I do reach out to. Folks like Tom Douglas, who, you know, are icons. And they are the best mentors, and the people who should be in your corner are the ones that will tell you when it's a terrible idea and that you shouldn't be doing those things. And I can tell you that folks like Tom Douglas have shot down more ideas than they've said yes to. So that's when you kind of know too that you it's time to go back to the drawing board.
Great. Next question. How has this experience changed the way you think about and the way you think about running a small business?
You know, Saver's mission before COVID was very simple. It was to serve joy. That hasn't changed post-COVID. And I think about how everything that we should do today, tomorrow, next year should still fit that mission. What has changed is that before, we were only serving a very small group of small businesses within Seattle, only the places that we physically could take guests to on our food tours. But now, our ability to impact a greater part of our community is magnified because of our donations that we have, the number of purveyors and merchants and artisans we get to work with and feature. So our impact is so much bigger now. So I think about what is it that we're really doing these days and what makes our customers so special. I think that Saver's become a purveyor of local pride, because our customers are people who care a lot about supporting the small business community. They don't want their neighborhoods to look dramatically different than it did pre-COVID. They care about Black lives. And so they are ready and able and willing to take a stand. And that's awesome. Like, that is such an incredible feeling to know that we're in this together and we're doing it. And I think that that's like probably the biggest aha. And my rally cry is like, okay, all right, we're going to be purveyors of local pride. I think that's what it's all about for us going forward.
Great, super, thank you. And the last question, when do you know when a pivot is not working and when you should quit that pivot?
I mean, for us, it's pretty simple. Like, when our customers tell us it's a terrible idea, mm-hmm. or we yeah. try it and it fails. And functionally, it just takes looking at your P&L statement and say, okay, if you're making less than you're spending, you know, it's a pretty straightforward thing. Like, okay, time to cut bait and ask your customers, like, what are you doing wrong? What can we do better? And then you'll find your answers. It just takes asking.
Okay, great. We have a few more questions that came in. Next question. Do you have any plans for a virtual experience, and what would make it special?
Yes, we have lots of plans to expand into the virtual space, and we are looking at what the best way for us to deliver those is. Obviously, we have a network of being able to deliver actual food products and ingredients to people's doorsteps. So our goal is to marry that ability with a virtual experience, be it a cooking class, be it a virtual food tour, or something that is really going to connect people using this universal language. So even though you're not sitting next to each other, you're still experiencing the exact same foods together with the guidance of a Savor Seattle guide or host.
Great. Next question. What advice do you have to someone who needs to make a change for their business to survive?
Yeah, I think we're all in that same boat. It's either you change or you don't survive, because we're in this for a really long time. It's not going away tomorrow. It is a global pandemic. So in absence of a vaccine, it does take simply looking at the data and historical trends. Look at all of the pandemics that we've ever had in our history. Spanish influenza had 3 waves. So, you know, I think about that reality, and it's better to start taking action today for worst case scenario, and then you can pare that back, than hoping and praying that it won't last that long, because the reality is it probably will. And that's unfortunate, but it's better to be safe than sorry and start thinking about what those dramatic changes are.
Yeah. Okay, final question. What scares you about the future? And then what excites you about the future?
Well, what keeps me up at night is not knowing if and when we should be investing and banking more into this new space. Food delivery is something that we've been doing now for, I think, 24 weeks or so. And that compares to 13 years of doing food tours. And now we're talking about getting into the virtual space. So again, never done it before. And I don't know if you've figured this out yet, but I'm awful at technology. So anything in that space is intimidating and scary to me. It's wild to know that having lived through that transition of COVID hitting us, that first week, seeing within days a stable, healthy business and economy here in Seattle crumble in days, just days. So I know how fast it can come and how fast it can go away. And so, you know, to the dismay of my family, I will say that I constantly am empowered by this feeling of feast or famine, because I don't know what tomorrow will bring. So that gives me energy to say, well, I got to work really hard today, because tomorrow might not be here. So I need to put in that work. But what gets me excited are all of these incredible new businesses that have cropped up that nobody knew about or thought we ever would have needed in our lives before COVID. And so that creativity is just really inspiring. And I get excited thinking about what we can do when we're not thinking about just ourselves in our own little COVID bubbles. And we are leaning in to band together, because our journey to get here today would never and will not be successful if it isn't in partnership, in tandem with people in our community.
Great. Thank you, Angela. Before we leave, just want to wrap up the webinar with a few takeaways. So one, when you're deciding to pivot, look at the data and trends. And then two, when deciding what to do, I thought this was a great point by Angela, identify the pain points in your customers' lives. Communication, that's been a theme throughout this whole conference. So communicate with transparency and candor and with your staff, keep them updated, even if it's daily, about the status of your business. When you do decide to pivot, do a beta test, ask for feedback, and then repeat. Angela gave a great example of, from feedback, she included the fresh flowers and the produce. And remember, your customers will give you some grace. This is new territory for all of us, and mistakes will happen, and people are more graceful about that than they probably would have been before times. And then I love the statement, building the parachute while falling off the building. I think we're all kind of doing that in one way or other these days. So Angela, thank you for that. And then finally, for challenges, there'll always be a lack of accurate forecasting. But then in the end, always ask for what you need and lean on your community for the things that you need to help build and sustain your business. And with that, Angela, I'd like to thank you once again for the beautiful presentation and taking some time to share with us. And before we go, I would like to thank our presenting sponsor, Kaiser Permanente, for sponsoring this wonderful event. So we'd like to thank them. So that's it for the conference. Thank you all for participating this week. We very much appreciate it. And feel free to fill out the survey at the end of this webinar. Let us know what you need to, let us know how else we can provide you with information and speakers. So with that, thank you very much and have a great weekend.